conversation in the house of God. I appreciate all the conversation and all the connections that are here today. What a joy. I tell you, it's thrilling to my mind to serve the Lord. I was listening to a man preach the other day about following the Lord. And he was giving detail about the adventure that God does when you follow Him. And really and truly, following the Lord is an adventure. If you've never set out to follow the Lord, you're in for a great trip. I'm telling you, He'll take you places that you can't even imagine, and He'll allow you to experience things that you cannot even understand. And one of these, today is one of those days. We have the privilege of baptizing Leah Jane here just a little bit, and my connection with England family goes back all the way to the beginning, to Mr. Delbert England. He was the very first man that I met in Claiborne County, and I shook his hand, and I said to my wife, I said, if everybody in Claiborne County is like this fellow, we're going to be all right. And to this day, I still thank God for that opportunity and how it all is connected. I just appreciate that so very much. This day is very special. And especially for all the people. And I found out that they are people in town like that. So y'all are good. Y'all are good. Whole town's full of people like that. I have really, honestly, I tell this story, I'll pray, but I tell this story a lot. When I came to Claiborne County, I knew nobody but the Lord and my wife, and honestly. And I left everything I knew and loved, and my wife and family, and her family's there. My family's in Middle Tennessee. We knew nothing of anybody in Claiborne County. And I thought, man, why in the world would I move to a place that I don't know anybody? And boy, God has knitted my heart together with so many people in this town. And I tell people, I'm from Claiborne County. I'm here. I'm rooted. I'm in, you know. And I just appreciate the relationships that God has allowed me to accumulate in these 15 years. But anyway, let's pray together and then ask God's blessing. We've got a few people out and traveling and going about. People are filling in. Miss Tanya's filling in for Mr. Kelly. We appreciate her willingness to do that. And others, I'm sure, in and out. So let's pray and ask God's blessing on the service. Father, we come to you now. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. Lord, what a privilege it is to stand in this place at this moment and this time. The long term, the longevity of this moment is thrilling to me. Lord, help us to be faithful. The times that the devil slides up and tells us to throw in the towel, to give up or to quit, I believe you give us a little fruit along the way to ignite us yet once more and to bring it to pass that it's worth serving you. Help us to follow you and help us to lean on you in these days of trouble, these days of adversity, the days of the darkness seems to be prevailing, but I know the Spirit of God is doing a great work. Thank you for this family. Thank you, Lord, for the families that are here, the visitors here for the first time, and those that have come faithfully. I pray you'll bless them. Every single person in this room, I pray, be touched by the Holy Spirit today and use that which is supernatural to move us towards you. Help us to know that we've met with you. Speak to us through the preaching. I want to be used of you, Lord, to be a mouthpiece. I pray the Spirit of God would fill me fresh and new with the Holy Ghost that I might say everything that would please you. Bless now. We sing and worship you and glorify you and thank you for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand if you don't mind. 180 is a song. We're going to stand on the promises, and I trust you are. But let's lift your voice and sing as unto the Lord. Would you do that?
Hymn number 180. If you would, grab a hymn book. We're working on getting the screen up. If the words come on in the middle of the song, hop on over. But for now, hymn 180, Standing on the Promises. We'll sing the first and the last verse. 180.
Standing on the promises of Christ. Thank you.
singing hymn number 393, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Blessed Assurance.
Something, if you don't mind, I like to sing that third one once again. Something just went into my mind when I read that verse. It's a personal assurance. Do you know you're saved with a personal salvation? It's not a broad brush. We all can be saved, but it's a personal salvation. And we get to the chorus. I'd like to ask Miss Tanya to drop that out, and let's sing that chorus. Notice that in this chorus, it says, this is my story. I love that. Praising my Savior. This is my story, my song. Everybody in here has got a salvation testimony. If you don't, you can have one today. But if you're in this room and you can't say, this is my salvation, you're lost. And you need to be saved. It's simple. You're not a second-class citizen. You just need to be saved. You just need to be born from above. So if you cannot sing this, I pray, I'm serious, I pray the Holy Ghost conviction be upon your heart that you cannot say, this is my salvation. This is my song. Let's sing that if you don't mind doing that one more time.
On the third.
Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my
singing, you may be seated.
Amen. Very good. Well, I wanted to have maybe a quick testimony from the young people that went to Youth Congress. And we had one get saved down there, praise the Lord. That was a blessing. Many of them were stirred for the Lord. Many of them were touched. Many of them were spoken to by the Lord, and God's done great work in their hearts. And I wanted to have them here today, this morning, and a couple of them are here. But sadly, not only did they share in their spiritual achievement, they also spread their sickness around. So a large percentage of them are home with a stomach bug. So we'll do it maybe next week. But I want to give you a big thank you to those that supported those young people and gave to the youth camp. And if you still want to give to that, you can just designate it for the offering. It cost about $2,100 to send all those, the fuel and the time and the food and all those kinds of things. So if you'd like to give to that, feel free to do that. But we were down there the Friday night to pick them up. And, of course, we guys and us went in to get their luggage and get them all gathered back up. And I just was standing on the deck. Of course, the dormitory for the ladies was different for the boys. But I went in to the deck, and on the in the back of the deck, there was a section that would have been the kitchen, I guess. But there was like 19 mirrors with a chair under every one of them. And I just stood at the deck, and I thought, I know what that's for, makeup. But I could tell we were in a girl's dormitory. But I wanted, we'll do that next week. Some of them are a little puny, but Bryce got saved, and we thank God for that. But Friday night, you ought to go online and listen to it. There was 300-plus young people in that choir singing. And I'm telling you, as soon as we sat down, my wife and I, boy, we were soaking it up. Those young people were singing their hearts out and giving God the glory. And, man, that was so good. I just, such a blessing. And I'll get them to testify next week. But God did a great work in their hearts, and we appreciate that. Well, just by way of announcements, a couple things. If you're taking notes, Miss Lois would like to see the Awana leaders right after the service. We have a real brief meeting with all the Awana leaders, if you wouldn't mind doing that. And then next Sunday, we won't do it this Sunday, but next Sunday is our safety meeting with our safety team. Got a couple things we want to go over. And then we've got a two-hour training session coming down the road. It's in your bulletin. The Men's Fellowship, Vacation Bible School is around the corner. That's up on our bulletin slides. And so if you want to be involved in that, I think... we're going to have a great time. We're going to have wagons and buggies, and I think I'm going to bring a couple horses here, let the kids play and pet on them and rub on them and do all those kinds of things. And so we're going to have a great week. That's the 25th through the 29th. If you know anybody that want to bring their children, we'll have it through that age, 6th grade through K through 6th. So if you'd like to participate, you know somebody that would like to have their children here, please bring them and drop them off, and we'll have a good time. Or end of the year business meeting is around the corner. And then also, I'd like to make an announcement. Some of y'all may have heard of this. For years, there's been talk of having a Boys and Girls Club in Claiborne County. Well, they've brought it to fruition, and they've asked me to be the director of it. And so I've accepted that position, just trying to do what I can do for the Boys and Girls Club of Claiborne County. And so tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock at SMS School, they will be starting the Boys and Girls Club of Claiborne County. It's been talked about for a long time. It's been spoke about, but they're going to get it to go this Monday. So be praying about that. And if God would help me, I'm going to try to do my best to influence the generation that's behind us and generation that's around us. And I'm humbled that they would even ask and humbled that I would have the opportunity to be a part of it. But young people... One preacher said, if he had his life to live over again, he would invest more in young people. And I think we're losing it because we're not reaching the generation. We're not going back to the generation. The Bible says in the book of Acts, David served his own generation. And it was in my heart last Sunday when I was at the park to tell you, when I preached on Encompass the City, that was in my heart to talk about that then, but I just didn't have the full detail on it to this past week. But I thought, God just brought that message to my heart. I'm going to try to encompass the city. And you do it through people. You do it through young people. You do it through generations. And I'm excited about it. And I hope God's going to use it and bless it in a big way. But you pray for me, and I know God will do something great there. Well, let's do something. Let's greet one another. If you're here for the first time, and I'm sure many are there for the baptism, we'll have you ready to visit. But let's stand together. The children are going to come along. Say hello to the pastor, and let's greet somebody. Would you mind doing that?
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Amen. Well, thank you, brother. If you have your Bibles, or turn with me to the book of Joshua, the book of Joshua. I thought of that song when we often run after things that are going to burn up, aren't we? We run after things that don't even last. Joshua chapter number 7, I'm going through the book of Joshua. And man, God has stirred my heart. And this morning, I want to give you a thought that I'm sure that touches every single person. I'm sure you have lived long enough, if you've lived any length of time, you have participated in something or you have been active in something and find out all that was for nothing. Have you ever got involved in something and, man, put your time in it, put your energy in it, man, you've worked, you've labored just to have it thrown away? Well, that was for nothing. Several years ago, I was helping build the JCPenney's there in West Knoxville. And so I was doing the underground digging and going on. And The boss said, he said, if you can get this done in a certain amount of time, there's a bonus. And man, we put that thing in gear and we got her done. And I remember going home from that work job site and he called me and I said, man, we got her done, didn't we? Got it done. Under time, radar, what's a bonus? I thought he was calling me with a bonus, you know. He said, no, I got bad news. I said, what? He said, we had the wrong prints. It was flipped. The bathroom was supposed to be on this side of the building, and it was on this side of the building. So if you go to JCPenney, when I go into JCPenney's in West Knoxville, it's been maybe not even there anymore. But when I go in that building, I just sort of cringe. I'm like, ugh, I hate this building. I remember being so excited about the bonus, but all I really realized was that they gave us the wrong prints. And he said, so all that was for naught. I remember going back the next day and cutting all that out, just not really cutting it out, just sort of dissolving of it and covering it up and going over here and starting a new spot. Simply because of some mistake, simply because of some error. And I thought, going home, well, that was for absolutely nothing. I mean, the labor, the time, the sweat, the tears, the work overtime, the lack of family time, all the things was involved was for nothing. I was a little upset about it. Still a little mad about it. I boycott JCPenney for that. Wasn't their fault. But I thought, man, that was for nothing. Think about that physically just for a moment. How many episodes, how many things in your life you have done, wash your car and it rained. If you want some rain, just wash your car, right? It gets a little dry outside, get some car wash going. Physically, that's disheartening. Physically, that is destructive. Physically, that is bad. But just for a few minutes, I want you to think about spiritually. Dying for nothing. Just for the next few minutes, I want you to ponder your life for a few minutes, and I want you to see, and I want you to evaluate, and I want you to inventory your life just for a few minutes while we're together, and I want you to ask yourself this question: am I doing this for nothing? Am I doing what I'm doing just to find out at the end of the day it was for nothing? It was for zero. There is no eternal gain in this. There is no eternal accomplishment here in this motive. I'm convinced, and I believe with all of my heart, that the devil is doing a masterful job in getting us to a place where we're involved in things that do not matter to keep us away from the things that do matter. Eternity is all that matters. When you draw your last breath, it doesn't matter your bank account. It doesn't matter the car you drive. It doesn't matter the clothes you wear. It only matters what you've done for God. It matters. Died for nothing. As mad as I was that day when I left JCPenney's, as mad as I was at the effort that I put forth, as mad as I was, think of Judgment Day. Let that ponder just for a few minutes. And I hope the voice does not cry out, that was for nothing. Your life, Job says, is like a weaver shuttle. They're clicking off, aren't they? Just like that, they're clicking off. And you're going to meet God quicker than you realize. Maybe not 70, maybe not 80, maybe not 90 years old. Maybe tomorrow. Achan is that great example. As I was going through the book of Joshua, and I get down to Achan, verse number 1 of Joshua 7. You have your Bibles there. Let's read just a few verses. And may the help of God, just for the next few minutes, let's think of this topic, this thought. I died for nothing. In Joshua chapter 7, verse number 1, but the children of Israel committed to transgress in the cursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabadi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, took the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. And Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is beside Bethaven, on the east side of Bethel, and spake unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, And make not all the people labor thither, for there are but few. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. The men of Ai smote of them 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate even unto Shibari, and smote them in the going down, whereof the hearts of the people melted and became as water. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell upon the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord unto the evening, and he and the elders of Israel, and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, "Alas, wait a minute. What's going on?" Alas means hold up a minute. What's happening? Why have we lost 36 men to a little bitty country, a little bitty city like Ai? Joshua said, something has happened. I mean, take about 2,000 or 3,000. It's no big deal. It's small task. Y'all should be able to go out and knock that off pretty quick. Get on back here. Don't send everybody. No big deal. Small task until sin gets in. Be very careful with sin, because sin will cause things to be larger than they are. It's no big deal. It's a small task. It's something very small. Go up there and smite them. The people of Ai killed 36 of Joshua's men, and when the news got back to Joshua, he sought the Lord and said, "Lord, what has happened? Why did I lose 36 men?" God said, "Because there's sin in the camp, Joshua." So Joshua took inventory, and Joshua called a meeting, and he begins to talk to them. You can see it down verses 7, verse number 8, verse number 9, verse number 10. And God tells him in verse number 10, "And the Lord said unto Joshua, Get thee up, wherefore liest thou thus upon thy face? Israel has sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant which I commanded them, for they have taken of the accursed thing, and they have also stolen and disassembled also, and they have put it even among their own stuff." I think something very fascinating about those words. God said, "They have, they have, they have." But it wasn't a they. It was a him. What God was saying to Joshua about Achan, your sin is not singular. When you sin, you don't sin in a singular fashion. What I mean by that is, it don't just affect you. Sin does not see, the devil has done a masterful job in getting us to understand and get us to think that if we sin, it only affects me. It does not. It affects everybody that's involved. It infects family. It infects multiple families. Matter of fact, the Bible says in the Old Testament that he'll pass the iniquity down to the third and fourth generation. You know why our generation, which we live now, is in terrible trouble? It's because generations before us did not seek God. And you know what will be the downfall of our generations following us is when we don't seek God. It'll pass down, it'll pass down, it'll pass down. And God was telling Achan, you took of the accursed thing. I told you back in chapter 6, don't you touch of the silver and the gold and the garments. Don't you take of that stuff. I'm getting a little ahead of myself here. But Achan was overcome with temptation. He just couldn't stand it. One man said it this way. He says, sin is like an iceberg that sank the Titanic. Only a very small percentage of the iceberg was seen. The unseen part of the iceberg is what sunk the Titanic. They said 90% of the iceberg that sunk the Titanic was under the water. That means 10% of what they saw thought was going to be the damage. There's 90% of it. That's exactly the way sin does. Sin shows you 10% of it, but right underneath of it, there's 90% of tragedy and trauma and heartache and difficulty that the devil never shows you. He keeps the water of deceit over the 90% of sin that he wants you to indulge in. The unseen sin, one man called it, does the most damage. Another phrase I come across I thought was good. Sin will cause you to lose what you lust after, and then it will steal what you love. Sin doesn't play fair. And when we get the idea that sin is easy to handle and easy to control, you have deceived yourself and you've allowed the devil to deceive you. Sin is like a monster. I tell the story, I liken it to sin. I remember being down at the University of Tennessee and down there at the Aquatic Center. I remember I was on that job several years ago and I never forgotten it. God is just embedded in my mind about steam. Steam is like an absolute animal. And I watched steam when they would heat that water up and put that steam through that pipe. Carbon steel pipe, 6-inch carbon steel pipe that is 3/8 thick in sidewall. I watched 6-inch carbon steel as they charge that steam and then it travels through that pipe. I watched it roll that 6-inch carbon steel in either directions, 4, 5, and 6 inches. And I'm standing there just absolutely amazed. Steam fascinates me. As it travels through that pipe, and he said, you know how we know if we've got a leak? I said, how's that? He said, they take a broom, and they hold a broom out, and they walk into the room like this. And the steam is so hot and so violent that when it walks in with that broom, and if it cuts the broom off, they've got a leak. He said, man, that's dangerous. It'll cut your head off and cauterize it all at the same time. You'd fall in your tracks dead. Steam is dangerous. But can I tell you this morning, sin is dangerous. And sin will cause you to live your life and die for nothing. Sin will cause us to get blurred in our vision. Sin will dilute our judgment. Matter of fact, if you'll read these verses in chapter 7 of Joshua, you'll find that there's 10 things listed that Achan lost. One, he lost himself. He lost the silver. He lost the garment. He lost the gold. He lost his sons. He lost his daughters. He lost his oxen. He lost his asses. He lost his sheep. And he lost his tent. I had a little funny thought when I thought about Achan and his golden garments. I had a fleeting thought. If you'll read those stories, you'll find that Achan stole a Babylonian garment. A Babylonian garment and its look and the way it was imaged was totally different than the children of Israel. Now let your imagination process just for a minute. If someone walked into this room dressed up like Elvis, would we notice? Let's just be honest. I mean, we don't want to be judgmental, but we'd be like, what is that cat doing? Matter of fact, several years ago, Elvis did walk in this building. He was not the real one. But I'm sitting right here. I'm going to run a rabbit just for a minute. Right? I'll be right back. I was sitting right here, and Rex was doing the music. Rex probably remembers. And we were closer that time. We'd get along get better, I guess. And I looked and I said, Elvis has walked in this building. He was an impersonator. You remember, Rex? He was an impersonator. Elvis walked in this room and sat down. He sat right back there where Pinky and Ted are. Right there is where you're in Elvis's seat, Ted. He's probably signed underneath of it. Let your imagination go just for a second. The garment that he stole, he could not have worn without being known. He could have not have picked up the gold and spent it. Where are you going to spend a shekel of gold among the children of Israel who have nothing? Oh, boys, look what I got. Big pat of gold. Where are you going to spend it, Achan? Big pot of silver. I mean, think about what sin has diluted in this man's mind. He has got something he cannot wear. He's got something he cannot spend. He has got something that's going to be found out as soon as he pulled the curtain back and showed them what it was. They're going to know he got it from Babylonian. They're going to know. Isn't that just like sin? Sin tricks you, and he tricks me into thinking that I could spend it. He tricks me to think I'm going to use it. He tricks me to think that I'm going to benefit from it. The whole time, we look like a fool. We look like an absolute idiot walking in with a Babylonian garment and a wedge of gold here that probably weighed 10 pounds. He probably couldn't even carry it. If he had a backpack, he'd had it in a backpack. That's why we pick backpacks out here, but we check backpacks. Had silver on his side. I mean, think about the logic in this. I mean, Achan has absolutely lost his mind. Why? You know why? Notice here with me. Look what it says. Let's look at verse number 21. What has got into Achan's mind? Go with me to verse 20. The Bible said, "And Joshua said unto Achan, My son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me." And Achan said to Joshua, here it is, beloved. Listen very closely, because here is what happens to you and I. I'm going to show you how to make it not happen, but here's what happens. "And Achan answered Joshua and said, Indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done." Well, thank God he confessed. That's a good road of repentance right there. To be restored, you got to repent. Notice verse 21, and I circled this every time he said it. "When I saw." That's the first step to die with nothing, is what you see. "When I saw the spoils, a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels, I coveted." So I saw, the next step is I coveted, and the next step is I took. Notice he said, verse number 21, "I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it." So Achan has allowed sin, he's allowed his flesh, he has allowed circumstances to overwhelm him and to cause him to covet and to get and to look at things that he should not have and not touch. And this word conception came into my mind. I look up the word conception. It just simply means to form or to devise a plan. One man said it this way: when lust and temptation meet, conception takes place and the offspring is sin. And when sin has done its great work, death is the result of it. You know the end of all sin is death. Matter of fact, let me read it to you in James chapter 1, verse 14. "But every man is tempted." We're all tempted, by the way. "When he is drawn away of his own lust." See, here's the great dividing line. When we are tempted, yes, maybe. But then it becomes your choice and my choice to follow through. There's a stopping point. There's a red light. There's a stop sign. There's a turn right, turn left, go forward. Right there, when you and I find ourselves in temptation. When Achan, no doubt, he was in the middle of the war, middle of the fight, middle of the heat of the thing. He came across this Babylonian garment. What should he have done? Class, walked away. When he came to that moment of time when he was tempted and he saw that glittering gold and that shiny silver and that garment looking so sweet and kind and probably was his size. It was a 42 regular. He put that baby on. I'm just letting my imagination. Could you imagine picking that thing up out? It was probably had blood on it. There was a battle. I mean, it was thrown in the dirt probably. I mean, they're destroying this city. So it wasn't like it was hanging in a cleaner somewhere. I mean, he had to have dug and knocked the dirt off of it, and he put it on. I can't imagine. He'd probably be like me. I'd go behind somewhere where nobody wasn't looking. He put that thing on, and it fit great. I mean, it fit like a glove. This has got to be the Lord. This thing fits me. That's what the devil will do you. Get you to thinking it fits, get you to thinking it's right, get you thinking it feels good. And look here, it might for a minute, but there's only a pleasure in sin for a season. And here's old Achan, man, he's got that garment. At that moment, he should have walked away. Temptation, yes. Eyes glittering, yes. He should have turned his back and walked away. I like Joseph. When Potiphar's wife came in and carried on with him, you know what he did? He left his coat, but he kept his character. Here, the Bible says, but every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust. Notice, and enticed. Then, that word then, verse 15, when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. This is why Achan died with nothing. If this morning you're at a crossroads, you got temptation lingering ahead of you, you're going to die with nothing if you're not careful. Thank God for restoration. Thank God for repentance. Thank God for God's grace and mercy. Aren't we glad for that? Amen, we are. One man said we ought to treat sin as a death trap. I may have told y'all, but I've told some people around the house, I'm on a task, a mean one. I'm after every rat that lives in my barn. I'm on a mission. Yesterday, I was fooling a little truck, and I had a tarp. I've done killed about 14. You think I'm kidding? I'm talking about rats. I'm talking about it looked like a tail, like a pencil. I pulled old tarp back off that motor, and one ran out of that motor, and when it saw me, it went right down between my legs. So you're talking about dancing. I'm not scared of them, but I don't want them on me. Especially when they stand up and clap at you. Huge. Oh, get out of here. Rats. Literally rats. But I walk in the barn, I got them big traps, you know, they're about 9 inches long. One got my finger, I got a bruise right there on my finger, it got me the other day. When I walk in the barn, I see two or three men, I'm like, yeah. Get you some at. The cheese wasn't free. I joy in it. They thought the cheese was free. You know what sin will cause you to do? It's free. It's free. Until, bam, you're dead. It's a trap. It's a trap. Sin is a trap. It's a death trap. Satan is trying to get us to see and trying to get us to think that sin is not a big deal. It's a big deal. Stay away from it like a caged animal. Stay away from it like it's something that will destroy you, because it will. Don't kid yourself into thinking you can handle sin. Achan thought he could handle it. Next time temptation comes your way, stop and think about a couple things. Think about all the things you've worked for. Think about all the things that God's allowed you to accomplish. Think about all the things that God has allowed you to be involved in for His glory and honor. Every bit of that will be stripped away. Sin will steal every bit of it and leave you with nothing. When temptation comes my way, you know, one of the things that comes to my mind is Twin City Baptist Church. You know who he'd like to take out? He'd like to take me out. Not that I'm anything special. But you know, if he'd take me out, he'd take you out. I'm preaching to myself this morning, because sin wants me just as much as it wants you. And more visibility you've got, more influence you've got, the more he wants you. I'm treading lightly, man. I tell you, I got opportunities been given to me, and influence has been opened up, and boy, that's staggering. That's staggering to me. And every day of my life, oh God. Don't let me succumb to that temptation. Don't let me succumb. Don't let me give up. Don't let me throw away. Don't let me pitch in the trash. Everything I've been able to help get part of. Because just that fast, it'll go away. You can live 15 years, you can live 50 years and do right. It'll be dissolved in a moment of time. It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. Let me give you three things. We'll go home. How to keep you dying for that, keep you from dying for nothing. Notice verse chapter 6, verse 17, quickly here. Heed instruction. Heed instruction. If in chapter 6 and verse 17, if Achan, no doubt he heard, he was listening, he was in the group, he got the memo, he got the instructions. In chapter 6, verse 17, God told God told Joshua about Jericho and about Ai, don't touch the stuff. Verse 17 of Joshua 6, the city shall be accursed, even it and all that are therein, to the Lord. Don't touch the stuff. Don't touch the spoils. Don't touch it. Achan already knew that. Achan already had understood he was not supposed to touch the stuff. Verse 18, and ye in any wise keep yourself from the accursed thing, lest ye make yourselves accursed. Can I say it any plainer? Could God say it any clearer? Don't touch the stuff. Several years ago, I did something real bad to Miriam. I put an electric fence up, and I said, don't ever touch the fence. Don't ever touch the fence. I said it 14 times. Don't ever touch the fence. One day she said, Dad, is the fence on? I said, no, you can touch it, honey. No, it's on, honey. No, it's, oh, yes, you can touch it. I've cut it off. I didn't cut it off. Ah! I said, sorry. I didn't cut it off. It bit her. The instructions were wrong. Tell you something, when God gives instruction, He means it. If He said don't touch it, don't touch it. Sin will always be in disobedience to God's instructions. God will never give you instructions that will lead to sin. But when He gives you instructions, it will keep you from sin. Moms and dads, same way, we know about this parenting, don't we? Well, you don't parent your child in hopes they get disciplined. You don't set up scenarios, or you don't set up training sessions in your home or for your children in hopes that they fail. You're in hopes of training them. You're in hopes of saying, I hope you to accomplish. I want you to win. I want you to understand this so this does not happen. Don't run out in the road, baby, because you'll get run over by a car. Don't do this, honey, because this will hurt you. The instructions are there for value and for life and death sometimes. God said, don't touch it. Leave it alone. He didn't heed the instruction. I mentioned it already. Second one, he recognized the temptation, but he didn't flee from it. Let me give you 1 Corinthians. I'll move on. 1 Corinthians chapter number 10. Listen to verse 13. There hath no temptation taken you, but such is common to man. Let me say this real quick. There is no temptation, according to the verse I just read to you, that you can't get away from. I'm just weak in that area, not by the help of God. I just got problems in that area, preacher. Not with the help of God, you don't have an excuse. He said, there is no temptation taken you, but such is common to man. But God is faithful. Hallelujah, right there. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but with the temptation also make a way to escape that you may be able to bear it. That's Bible. I just read to you, you have no excuse to sin. God told us. God warned us. He did not heed the instruction. He did not recognize the temptation as being detrimental. And the third thing I want to show you is simply just remove yourself. It's simple. Just stay away from it. Not today. Willow said the other day she wanna take a nap. I said, you wanna take a nap? She said, not today. Hey, when Satan raises his ugly head and pitches temptation at you and causes you to yield, you need to look at him and say, not today. Not today, and probably not tomorrow. You know why Daniel lived clean? In Daniel chapter 1, verse number 8, you know why he lived clean? Because he purposed in his heart. He said, no, I'm not doing that. You know when you need to set up boundaries? It's before it happens. Young people, listen to me. When someone sticks a cigarette in your mouth or a joint or heroin or alcohol or some sort of drug, you need to say no now before that happens. It's already in your mind right now. No, I'm not going to partake in precarious living. I'm not going to partake in alcohol. I'm not going to partake in sexual behavior. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to set up boundaries. You know why? Because when it comes, temptation is so strong. Temptation, I'm telling you, you think you're strong because you're 16, 17, 18, 19, but temptation is stronger than you are. And peer pressure does not stop at the sixth grade, adults. We're all tempted to do wrong. But may God help us to heed the instructions, recognize temptation, be on the lookout for it. I'm not saying to dabble in it. I'm saying to avoid it. Look here. If there's a bomb right there, I'm not going to walk up and say, oh, look at that big old bomb right there. No. I know that is a bomb. That get away. Sin, that's sin. No, that's Satan. No, not today. Get away from it. Remove yourself. I mean, it's so simple. But yet, in the moment, in the time, it's so easy to yield. One last verse, and I'm closing. Proverbs 22, verse 3. A prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. The prudent man, he's looking for it. He's saying, no, I'm avoiding that one. Nope. 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 Foreseeing it. He says, walk circumspectly. I'm gonna walk over here. You ever played that twister game? You know? Oh, my God, help us. Let's pray together.
I have a little stool, but this is better. You know, I think about the Lord and his earthly ministry, and everywhere he went, he was influencing children. And the law says they put him in his arms. I've always said if Jesus came into the church building physically, he'd go to the nursery. We appreciate this so very much. Miss Aaliyah Jane has been wanting to get baptized for a long time. And I think that's great. I like to tell parents it's a conscience thing. It'll bug them. If they're really, truly saved, it'll bug them. It'll want to. And she's been a witness. Daniel was telling me about her going to, was it Disney there, witnessing the people in line. You saved? Hey, that's precious. That's precious. She's more of a witness than most adults. You ever stood in line and asked somebody they saved? This is good. This is precious. This is Leah Jane, and she's going to come and follow the Lord in believer's baptism. Upon your public profession of faith in Christ, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bear with him in baptism. Raised to walk in newness of life. I like it when you see teeth. I do this every time because you never know what God does in hearts of people. We keep it warm all day. And this evening we'll have service at 5 o'clock and it'll still be here. If you need to follow the Lord in believer's baptism, you'll do it today. Daniel and Nicole are going to join the church today, so we're going to maybe have a song and If you don't mind, stay around just for a moment. She's going to get cleaned up here, and we'll have a picture or two. But if you don't mind singing there, if you don't mind, Daniel, and that song you were going to sing when I come down. Yeah, very good. And I'll let you.
It's always sweet and precious. I want to ask if the family wouldn't mind coming and stand here in the front. She made her way up. Yeah, there she is. Very good. I was just sitting there thinking, four generations. Mr. Delbert, Mr. Danny, and Daniel, and now Aaliyah. What about that? That's great, isn't it? Right, brother? Good. I think she got saved at Vacation Bible School, right? Right, yeah. Come on up here, brother. JD? Yeah. Yeah, JD and him are having Vacation Bible School. That's where Aaliyah got saved. He probably run out up there, didn't he? You run out on your people, didn't you? Oh, there she is. Come along with her if you want to. Very shape, brother. Brother, love brother JD. He's good. That's precious. I appreciate anybody that's not spiritually selfish. That's what I think about this. If they get saved anywhere, any place, under anybody's leadership, and anybody anywhere, chicken barn or church pew, it don't matter to me. I appreciate that. I appreciate that. What a blessing. What a blessing when people get saved. It doesn't matter where, and doesn't matter how, and as long as they trust Christ. Amen. Very good. Very good. Let's pray together. Let's dedicate this family. We're going to join and put their life in here. Father, what a tremendous, tremendous testimony. What a tremendous testimony of your grace. Thank you that you don't give up on us. Thank you, Lord, you're still saving. You're still saving our own in spite of us. What a blessing. What a blessing. Thank you so much for today and just getting to experience this and get be a part of this. Lord, I had no idea. I had no idea that day that I shook Delbert England's hand that I'd be able to baptize his great-granddaughter. What a joy. What a joy. I ask that you would just bless this family in a special way as they seek to live their life and their influence for you and for thy kingdom's sake. Lord, we pray for Aaliyah. She's made a great step of obedience. And I pray you might bring conviction upon an adult's heart in this room that does not know Christ and has never followed Lord in believer's baptism. I pray you'll do a great work there. Bless now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you come across and say hope to these? Yeah, Cohen's preaching today. Come along and say something to these folks, would you?